Welcome to Our City, and joining me this week for this week's segment to discuss the Elizabeth Development Company's 40th year celebration is Bill O'Day, who's the executive director. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. So before we get started, let's tell the people a little bit about yourself, please.
Well, I've been the executive director for 3 years now. I've actually worked for the company since 1993, so next year will be my 25th anniversary. I was a project manager, I ran the Urban Enterprise Zone, then I was a deputy director, and now I've been the executive director. In my nighttime job, I'm a Hudson County freeholder. Mayor Bullwage doesn't hold that against me, though.
Okay. Now, Elizabeth Development Company is located down in the port right now.
Correct. We're located at 205 First Street on the corner of First and Bond Street.
And you were there when you were on North Broad Street?
I was there on North Broad Street. I was there on 1045 East Jersey Street in the Bunnell House, which was a historic building.
And just in case someone doesn't know the function of the agency, what does the EDC do?
Well, we do a variety of things. We assist businesses that are looking to locate to the city of Elizabeth, businesses that want to expand their operation here. We make low interest loan money available. We take subordinate positions. So if a bank would only loan X amount of dollars and they're not willing to take a larger risk, we fill those gaps. Our interest rates are as low as 3%. We also help developers. If people are developers looking to do development projects, they meet with me. We talk about things that might be available from the city, incentives that are available from the state. We also have a program now that's called an on-the-job training program. So we assist individuals in training for jobs. We also assist individuals in looking for jobs. We do job searches for individuals. We also do soft skill training. Mm-hmm. We're doing a hospitality training program that starts later this month. If anyone's interested in that, they should contact Myra Santana at our office, or if they want to do the soft skill training. So we do a lot of different programs to help people in the town.
And just so just in case we forget later on, what's the phone number for EDC?
Telephone number for Elizabeth Development Company is 908-289-0262.
Okay. And as we talk about a company that's been in existence for over 40 years, I'm quite sure over those years things have changed. How has EDC changed over those 40 years?
I think over the 40 years we've changed in the beginning, which predated me, it was basically an entity that did very small loans and also did some small development planning. We've now evolved into the fact that we do extensive training, job training program, job placement program. We're kind of like the right hand of the city when it comes to development. So we work closely with the city and developers in developing development plans, getting incentives from the state of New Jersey, sometimes getting pilots, payment in lieu of tax agreements from the city. And we've also expanded our loan program. So we do much larger loans. And also 40 years ago, there wasn't an urban enterprise zone.
Right.
We now have administered the urban enterprise zone for 20 years. And we continue to administer that to assist businesses in signing up and getting the benefits from the Urban Enterprise Zone program.
So the average person walks through the city, they really don't realize when they pass a building, but that's the result of EDC's work from revitalizing neighborhoods to supporting economic growth and job creation throughout our community. EDC continues to be an active part in our city. Based on that, please tell our viewers about EDC's role in creating opportunities by collaborating with government, community, and the business sector.
So to just take each one separately, so collaborating with government, obviously we work closely with the city. I worked very closely with Mayor Bullwage and the city on the Jersey Gardens Mall, now Simon Property Mall. In that particular regard, we had to assist in getting state legislation changed to enable that mall to get built. We also worked closely with the Housing Authority, particularly in the Hope 6 project. And in that particular regard, we had to assist them in identifying dollars and funds, especially for the infrastructure costs that were related to the housing and other development that took place in that neighborhood. Working with the community, we work with a variety of not-for-profits. We worked with Eport Presbyterian Center. We provided a substantial loan to them to be able to do a new building for them, where now the Elizabeth Port Health Center is located. And working with the business community, we're there everywhere from having seminars that assist businesses that are looking just take advantage of programs that the city has to making loans available to them, to taking advantage of tax credits and things that the state may have available to the business community.
So when you mentioned the mall, you said it very nonchalant, but I'm quite sure that's a major endeavor. Over the years, what are some of the biggest accomplishments for EDC?
Well, I mean, I thought I mentioned both of them in the list, but certainly the Jersey Gardens Mall. There's a project that created close to 5,000 permanent jobs. Not only was it the mall, but besides the mall, there are several hotels, several restaurants. We're now working with the city and with the developer on adding 400,000 additional square feet of space that will create at least 1,000 more jobs. So that's a major catalyst that sprung a lot of other development in the city. And Hope 6 was a major accomplishment for us because working with the Housing Authority, we were able to help replace those old, dilapidated housing sites, public right. housing sites, with new sites, with private management, with a better quality of life for the neighbors and the community that live down there. And we put a lot of UEZ money in with the support of the City of Elizabeth and Mayor Bowage to be able to make the infrastructure needed for the roads and the sewers in order to make that project happen.
When you talk about Hope 6 and other projects, to the average resident, we just see the end result. But for a project like that, roughly how long does it take to develop?
Well, that project from start to finish took over a decade.
Wow.
Starts with planning. We were able to get, which is one of the other programs that we have, we are designated Neighborhood Revitalization Tax Credit Neighborhood. Mm-hmm. We actually have two of them in Elizabeth, Eport and Midtown. Eport was first. So it started working with the Housing Authority, putting together a plan with the neighborhood, with the community, then applying for the funds from the federal government, then accessing UEZ money, and then the different phases. You know, that consisted of probably six different phases. Right. And now it's been around so long that we're working with the Housing Authority. They just got some tax credits, again, from the federal government to rehab and upgrade some of the first buildings that were done down there in the late 1990s.
Can you explain to our viewers about why mixed-use projects are efficient and effective in municipalities?
Well, mixed-use are very efficient and effective. In fact, we're located, obviously, in 205 First Street because the residential development generates the income necessary to support often the commercial or retail development. Mm-hmm. So while residential development is pretty easy to happen, especially affordable housing, because you get government subsidy either upfront in the form of grants or on an annual monthly basis, rather, to the tenants, those residential rents support the building. Usually commercial space and retail space lags. It takes longer to get going. And quite frankly, you often have to subsidize it, especially in neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're on Broad Street, that retail sells itself. Right. But if you're on First Street or Third Street or Second Street, those rents are often lower. So the residential rents that they bring in help support and subsidize the commercial or the retail rent. So that's what makes mixed use such an important program and project.
Okay. Can you talk about EDC's role in that project with Hope 6 and the service that we create to help residents improve their quality of life, like the original Retail Skills Center and job creation through the mall?
So the original Retail Skills Center was an idea that there was only one in the country, King of Prussia in Pennsylvania, and Councilwoman Patricia Perkins Auguste came to us and said, why can't we have one at Jersey Gardens? We then worked with the mayor, the city council, the state of New Jersey, put up the Urban Enterprise Zone money to get that started, and quite frankly, worked with the developer who gave us the space for free of charge. So we started that. That's grown and prospered from a retail skill center to a one-stop shop that offers more training now for men and women, gets them placed not only in jobs in the mall, but also jobs outside the mall, jobs in hotels, and in other particular areas. And the Hope 6, particularly in the building that we're in, the city gave community development block grant dollars, and those community development block grant dollars specifically subsidize the build-out of the space that we're located in. Okay. And without that, we couldn't afford the rent. in order to pay the mortgage necessary to make that space work. And in there, next to us, that residential is senior housing. So there are additional senior services on site as well as across the street in the Eport Presbyterian Center building.
Now, going back to the One Stop, formerly known as the Retail Skills Center, that's located within the mall.
Correct.
So if someone's in need of employment, they can get trained and possibly placed on the job.
Absolutely. Yeah, they offer, it's a one stop. That's why they call it One Stop. You go there, they help you with resume writing. They help you fill out an application. They get you certifications in retail skills, which helps get you placed in a job in the mall or somewhere else in retail. There are thousands of jobs in Midtown in all the retail establishments there. And then after they get the training done, they assist you with placement.
Okay. And pretty soon you have your gala coming up.
Yes.
After 40 years, you deserve something. Tell us about the gala event.
So the gala is going to be held on Wednesday, September 27th at 6 o'clock at Dolce, which is 17 Broad Street in Midtown Elizabeth. We're going to celebrate our 40 years. We're going to talk about our accomplishments. And quite frankly, we're going to recognize a number of individuals who have been part and parcel of the success of why we are where we are today.
And as you do this 40-year celebration, who are you honoring at the gala?
So we're honoring a number of individuals, including Mayor Bulwage. Mayor has been immensely supportive of economic development in the city, very supportive of the Elizabeth Development Company. He's also the head of the UEZ Mayor's Conference.
Okay.
And we continue to fight along with him to talk about bringing back the monies we used to get from the UEZ. So we're honoring him. We're honoring Councilman Manny Grover, who we worked with when, before he was at large, was the councilman for the Port area through the beginning of the whole Hope 6 project. We're recognizing Bill Jones from the Housing Authority, again, who we worked with through Hope 6. Denise Palazza from Simon from the Mall. Garcia Uniform, which is a small business located a block from us, which we've made some loans to, but also we've been able to get job placements there. And last but not least, Lifetime Achievement Award to Senator Raymond Lesniak. Ray Lesniak literally was elected the same year Elizabeth Development Company was founded. And as he winds down his career in the Senate, we want to recognize the many, many things he's done, especially behind the scenes in getting legislation passed. He was the driving force behind the Landfill Reclamation District, which is the law without which the Jersey Gardens Mall development would have never happened. He also did the Urban Transit Hub Tax Credit legislation and the Economic Redevelopment Growth Grant legislation, which enabled both the Wakefern development in Elizabeth as well as the Embassy Suites Hotel.
Now, throughout our conversation, you mentioned UEZ. Tell our viewers about the UEZ program and its benefits for businesses, shoppers, and how it supports local economy.
So the Urban Enterprise Zone benefit to businesses are they're able to charge a reduced sales tax, 50%, which is now 3.435, weird number, 3.475. State came up with a change, lowered it from 7% down 1/8. So they're able to charge that if they sell retail. They get an exemption on all their purchases. So if they buy furniture or desks or a flat screen TV for a waiting room in a doctor's office, they don't pay any sales tax on it. They're also potentially eligible for tax credits for hiring Elizabeth residents or people that come from the zones. The benefits to residents is they pay a less sales tax.
Right.
Go to IKEA, go to the mall, go to Midtown. Instead of paying 6.875, you pay 4.3875. So you get a 50% sales tax, which is a great benefit, and also the opportunity for individuals to get hired there. The one challenge we have in working with the mayor is many years ago, and Governor Christie has continued to do this, they've taken away the funds we get each year.
Right.
So we used to get somewhere between $4 and $12 million for programs, for infrastructure, for off-duty police officers, which is one of the programs we still fund at the mayor's request for the business districts. That money's not been given to us, have been taken by the state for the last 10 years. We're hopeful that the new governor, whoever the new governor is, will come up and give us some of those dollars back so we can again do real development and infrastructure investment and larger loans without the urban enterprise zone area.
Yeah, some of your funding's been cut in the last couple of years.
Cut it all. We're living off of recycling money from our loans and just dollars that we have left in reserve.
Okay. Before we wrap, please remind our viewers about the upcoming 40th year celebration, where it will take place and when.
So the 40th celebration will be on Wednesday, September 27th at 6 p.m. at Dulce, which is on 17 Broad Street. If anyone's interested in buying a ticket or an ad in the journal, they could call again EDC at 908-289-0262, and they would ask for Myra Santana.
And a website? Do you have a website?
www.edcnj, I think you'll get it that way,
.org. Nothing else, have dial the number.
There you go.
All
if
right.
you go EDC, Elizabeth Development Company, you'll be able to get it.
Thanks a lot.
All right.
Much
My pleasure.
Success and
My
great
pleasure.
Work for 40 years.
Thank you very
All
much.
Right. We'll be back with the second half of Our City after these words. Thank you.
We're an American original. Dependable, historic, nuanced. With all the comforts of home, even when you're just visiting. So we're celebrating for all that we've left untouched and all that we've changed. A place where the past meets the future. So consider this your invitation.
We've been celebrating here in Elizabeth for 350 years, and we're just getting started.
Welcome back to the second half of Our City, and I'm pleased to be joined for this week's segment with Brian Murray. He's the Boxwood Hall Project Specialist, and we're going to talk about Boxwood Hall. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Alonzo.
Now, prior to us starting, and is this your first time on the show?
It is.
Well, tell the viewers about yourself a little bit.
Oh, about me. I am the project manager at Boxwood Hall, but also of Liberty State Park.
Okay.
And Boxwood Hall exists under the auspices of Liberty State Park. I am also their archivist. And general dog's body, I think.
Okay. And basically, is that your role at Boxwood, or is it more to it?
That is basically my role. I'm a projects manager.
Okay. And in case there's someone watching this who does not know, tell us about Boxwood Hall. What is Boxwood Hall?
Well, Boxwood Hall is probably the only museum in Elizabeth, New Jersey. It is a home that was built in the 1750s. It was the home of Elias Boudinot, and then of Jonathan Dayton, the youngest mm-hmm. signer of the Constitution. And it's a wonderful place that more people should visit.
Now, we're talking about a historic building here, and it's 400 years old, maybe? 300?
No, 300.
300 years
about
old.
300.
How do you change or modify a building like that? Tell us some of the highlights that have been done over the years.
So before I got involved with the work that's currently been done, or recently been done, there was no wallpaper. There was just very white walls and not a lot of furniture. And it took 2 years of research into decorative arts and the history of the house. Mm. And it takes a lot of work. We were very fortunate that we received a bequest, because honestly, a lot of that work would have just been shelved. But as I said, we were fortunate, and the work has been done. And actually, we've just put on a new roof, so we're doing quite a lot.
Now, in addition to the new roof, are there any plans for any future updates?
We have a lot of plans. I'm not really at liberty to speak of them now
okay.
until they've been finalized. But we're always working to improve the site and make it more accessible to visitors.
So when we talk about a building 300 years, when you decide to redo a room, how do you go about it?
Well, you really have to decide, when you look at the room, who used the room, what period are you are interpreting, and then you have to choose things that the original occupants would have recognized. So we don't have any estate lists after Samuel Woodruff's passing, so we have an estate list from Samuel Woodruff, the builder of the house.
Wow.
But there are no estates list from Elias Boudinot or Jonathan Dayton. That's because Elias Boudinot sold the house to Jonathan Dayton, and Jonathan Dayton sold the house to his son-in-law, Mr. Spencer. So,
do you have deeds or any documentation from that? Or?
Oh, there's lots of.
They're originals.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. So. Okay. Now, how difficult is it to renovate while preserving the original decor?
It is difficult. It's an old house, and you have to respect that it's an old house. It also has to. It has to exist under a certain set of standards that are dictated by the state. Don't forget, we are a state property. We are state-owned property.
Okay.
So all of those things must be maintained, and anything you do in a museum house must be reversible, which everything we have done is reversible. So, but that's really the sort of technicalities of what we do. So really, it mostly relies on research.
Okay. Union County's Four Cities in a Weekend Heritage Festival. It's coming up in October.
Mm-hmm.
Does Boxwood Hall have anything special planned this year?
We do. We have two things. We always participate in that, what you just mentioned. But we also we have some tours coming up. One is on the 16th of September, and that is a tour of Elizabeth, that will be conducted by Catherine Craig, with whom you're familiar, and you were asking about earlier. She's my colleague there. Right. She'll be guiding the tour of the historic sites. And then I have a tour the weekend of Four Centuries, and that will be on the 21st. And that will be a tour specifically of Catherine Street and the historic buildings left in situ there.
Now, very quickly, what's some of the history of Catherine Street?
We know from several maps that William Pertree Smith, who lived in the Belcher Ogden house just before and during the Revolution, he built a rental property on Catherine Street in 1748.
Wow.
So you can really trace the sort of beginning of that street right from East Jersey Street, where Boxwood Hall is located, to Elizabeth Avenue.
Okay.
So it really runs the gamut of 1740s to probably early 20th century architecture.
And located across the street from Boxwood Hall is?
The Belcher Ogden House.
Okay. Now, besides the Four Centuries event, are there any other special upcoming events scheduled during the autumn season?
Well, just those two that I mentioned to you. So there, Catherine's Walk, which will be called the Footpaths of History.
Okay.
And my walk is called Look Up and You'll See Elizabethtown.
And what's some of the stops for Catherine? Where is she going?
Well, it's in conjunction with the First Presbyterian Church.
Okay.
So
Now we're talking about over by the courthouse.
Over by the courthouse.
On Broad Street.
Okay. The First Presbyterian. And so it'll start there, and it'll walk its way around to the church, probably past St. John's and several other historic areas.
And is that the church on Broad Street by the bank over there?
With the First Presbyterian, and then St. John's is over by the bank.
Right.
Right.
So that's, what, you said four stops, or is it more?
Oh, no, it's more.
Okay.
I don't have the itinerary in my head, but it's more.
So a lot of people walk by, probably take it for granted, but there's a lot of history here in Elizabeth.
Oh, absolutely. Elizabethtown, as it was called, was the epicenter of the American Revolution.
Right.
So most people don't understand that, or they've forgotten. So when New York was basically invaded by the British in the 1770s, a lot of the patriotic families had to flee. A lot of them ended up in Elizabethtown.
Right.
Elizabethtown also, I don't know how to say this well, offered up about 20 officers into the revolutionary cause. That's an incredibly high amount of officers. So 3 days after the founding of the Society of the Cincinnati, our very own Elias Dayton was named the first president of the Society of the Cincinnati for New Jersey.
Right.
So it's very historic.
On the side of where the walkway is, there's a church. Mm-hmm. How old is that church, do you know? On that side, McDonald's, Bobby's, and then there's the walkway, and then there's the church.
Well, you're talking about the First Presbyterian.
Yes. Well, across the street from First Presbyterian, there's a church that sits up by the bank on that side.
Oh, St. John's.
Yes.
I think it's in its present incarnation, it's from the 1840s, but I believe it's early 18th century as the congregation has existed there since the early 18th century.
And First Presbyterian, how old was that one?
Well, that congregation goes back to the late 17th century. So if you go through the, if you walk through the graveyard, you'll see tombstones that are from the 1680s and 90s.
So if someone went to schedule a tour of Boxwood Hall, how can they go about scheduling that tour? And is it also possible to schedule a tour of some of the other facilities we talked about?
Definitely with the First Presbyterian.
Right.
Boxwood Hall, you can always call, you can visit our Facebook page, or I can just give you the number.
Give us the number.
908-282-7617. Okay. That's Boxwood Hall. We're open Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. However, if you have, if you can only make it on a weekend, call in advance. We'll try to accommodate you.
And do you have a website?
We have the State of New Jersey website. Right. However, we do have a Facebook page, so it's Boxwood Hall.
Now, as we talked about earlier with the documentation from the sales we talked about, are those documents on display in Boxwood Hall?
Or? No, and we don't own all of those documents. Okay. And much of the information that we have on Boxwood comes from several books.
Okay.
So, Thayer and Boyd and several authors have written about Boxwood or have included Boxwood, right, history of Boxwood in their books.
And who are some of the historic figures that stepped foot in Boxwood Hall?
Oh, how much time do we have?
Give me three names that someone at home would recognize.
Okay, well, I've already mentioned Elias Boudinot,
right,
Jonathan Dayton. So when Elias Boudinot was moving into Boxwood Hall, because he lived around the corner,
right,
and purchased the house from the estate of Samuel Woodruff. As he was moving in, this young man showed up on his doorstep with a letter of introduction. His name was Alexander Hamilton.
Hmm.
And of course, Jonathan Dayton was very good friends with Aaron Burr.
Okay.
So Aaron probably spent weekends there. Who knows?
George Washington?
George Washington was given lunch in the house. So the Marquis de Lafayette,
right,
came and spent a night in the house in 1824. So there's really quite a lot of history attached to the house.
So the streets, schools, and other buildings named after people who visited Boxwood Hall.
Yes.
Okay. So before we wrap, once again, please share with us the phone number to Boxwood Hall. If someone
are you
going to
make me do that again?
Yeah.
908-282-7617.
And what's the address to Boxwood Hall?
It is 1073 East Jersey Street. And we have parking.
Okay. Thank you very
much. Good thing, Elizabeth. You're welcome.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Thanks for tuning in this segment of Our City. And if you have time, make sure you go by historic Boxwood Hall. There's a lot of great things happening there, and I'm quite sure you will not be disappointed. Have a safe and wonderful week. Thank you.
We have some of the finest teachers in the country. And then they graduate. Kane University.